Hi, welcome to the start of the Euclidean Geometry 101 course. We will be focusing on the domain of plane geometry, which means that we will be staying in a two-dimensional plane. This is the geometry that is treated in the first six books of the ancient mathematician Euclid of Alexandria. The works of Euclid can arguably be called the most important mathematical textbook ever written. Only the Bible has seen more reprints. Euclid is called the father of geometry, though the contents of the elements, which is the name of his 13-volume work, have their basis in earlier works that are all but forgotten. As with so many works of antiquity, the originals of the elements have been lost, and the transcripts we possess are from several centuries later. Neither do we know much of Euclid's life or how he looks like. Though many of the proofs presented in the elements are his, the material presented was mostly prior knowledge. The real merit of Euclid is that he made a systematization of all the earlier knowledge in geometry and number theory and compiled it into a logical framework that is still a masterpiece today. We will construct in a similar way this course. The method that is used in Euclidean geometry is known as synthetic geometry. This method, also used by Euclid himself, starts from axioms and builds up the theory by using properties to prove theorems. It is a method that does not use coordinates at all. This is in contrast to analytic geometry, which uses algebra to pose and prove theorems. The reason why I prefer to use the synthetic method is twofold. First of all, it is an excellent method to practice logic. And secondly, one tends to lose oneself in the equations of the algebraic method while Euclid focuses on the visual construction and its properties. The lessons presented here are based off a French-Dutch mathematical book by Dalle and De Waele. So, without further ado, let's begin with lesson 1 by laying the groundwork of plane geometry, namely its axioms and postulates. In mathematics, axioms and postulates are the starting points for the various branches of it. They are the basic statements one must assume to be true. Some of those assumptions are self-evident, and one can ask why they should be stated. They are stated so that it becomes possible to build the whole collection of theorems of the field, in a logical way and without room for any doubt. They are thus not proven because it is the basis and the constraints within which the whole field of study resides. Though the two terms axiom and postulate have mostly the same meaning, within Euclidean geometry there is a clear difference. An axiom is something which is a statement about something that is common knowledge and obviously true. The postulates in Euclidean geometry are more about discovered constructions that are assumed to be possible. Euclidean geometry is based on five postulates. Two of them we will need right away. In order to talk about the postulates of Euclidean geometry, it is first necessary to define some concepts. In plane geometry, we consider the properties of objects in two dimensions. Two-dimensional objects, called surfaces, have two measures, length and width. One-dimensional line objects only have one measure, its length. Euclid called a line something with length but without breadth. A point is an object that has no dimension and no measure. It is in fact the notion of a location in the Euclidean space. Among the lines in the plane, the straight line is arguably the most important and the basis of the first two postulates. The first postulate states that one can always draw a straight line from one point to another point. The second postulate states that a finite straight line can be extended continuously at both sides. These two postulates actually describe the basic operation of a straight edge. To be able to construct the logical framework of Euclidean geometry, Euclid also included five axioms concerning very common notions. The first axiom states that if one thing is equal to a second thing, and the third thing is also equal to that second thing, then the first thing is equal to the third thing. Many among you will know this as a transitive relationship. The second axiom: if equals are added to equals, then the wholes are equal. Analogous to the second axiom, the third axiom states that if equals are subtracted from equals, then the remainders are equal. The fourth axiom states that if two things completely coincide with one another, then those two things are equal to one another. And the last axiom: the whole is greater than the part. So, through these notions, immediate deductions can be made using the postulates. Through these notions, the first postulate can be stated as: two points determine exactly one straight line, or in other words, two straight lines coincide completely if they have two points in common. Now, let's continue by naming some planar objects. A line segment is the part of a straight line between two points. Two line segments are equal if they can coincide completely. Adding two line segments together is the same as placing one line segment in line with the other. The sum of two line segments on the same straight line is the segment connecting the endpoints. A line segment is larger than a second line segment if it is the sum of that second line segment and a third one. And so we call the second line segment smaller than the first one. Points that lie on the same line are called collinear points. A broken line is a line that is not straight, but consists of parts that are straight. A broken line of which begin point and end point coincide is called a closed line or a polygon. A curve is a line that has no part, however small, that is straight. Any combination of points, lines or curves lying in the same plane is called a plane figure. And that's what we are gonna study in this course. This is the end of part 1. In next part, we will introduce angles and third postulate. If you like this series, consider subscribing to my channel.